Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Dean of the Pharmacy School, Joseph Guglielmo.
Thank you. So welcome, alumni, guests, students, faculty, staff, to this, the 150th celebration of the University of California, San Francisco beginnings. The contributions and the mark of the School of Pharmacy is unquestioned in that rich history. And as you'll hear, it bridges all aspects of the academic mission, including research, education, patient care models. And as I reflect even on this past weekend, we started off with a bang Thursday when Bill Smith, I don't know if Bill is here or not, but Bill gave a presentation of the area. There's Bill, a wonderful presentation on the origins of the Ninth Floor Project. Yesterday, we had the great opportunity to induct the class of 1965 into the Half Century Club, recognizing their 50-year reunion. And I have to say, as I talked about each of the individuals up there, the rich, impactful, and indelible history of the school came out again and again and again. And then we fast forward to today at this particular session, where our goal is to give you a very fast-paced, lively review of the history of this School of Pharmacy. Before I start, I want to point out a couple of dignitaries that are here and then a few more at the tail end. The first of which I'm going to point out my colleague and provost, Dan Lowenstein, who is here. Dan, if you could stand up and look. Dan represents everything that's good about UCSF. And then the second person I want to point out is Dr. Richard Carmona. Rich, if you could stand up and come up here if you would, Rich. Rich Carmona, some of you, hopefully all of you know, was the Surgeon General of the United States. More importantly, Rich and I, when we were children, we were up on Moffitt, 7th floor together. Rich as a surgical resident, me as, I don't know what I was in those days, Rich.
You were the smart guy.
No. And Rich has been absolutely a fantastic advocate of pharmacy and frankly of healthcare in general. And I asked Rich if he would just take a minute or two, give his thoughts. And I know he has to sneak out and see, what was the guy, Hawgood, you have to see. But Rich, please, we appreciate your comments.
Thank you, Joe. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. And Joe, it's always a privilege to see you. You know, we were kids on the wards back then, and Joe and I met when I thought I knew something about pharmacy practice, and Joe was our clinical pharmacist. And he taught me the importance of pharmacy. And we rotated for years together on different services, general, vascular, and so on. And I never forgot those friendships that we forged literally decades ago. As he grew up, I grew up, he had children, a daughter we were just talking about who's a pharmacist, and then I remember not too long ago reading in the UCSF bulletin that he had become dean, and I was just so proud to have remembered all of the great times I had with him, long days, long nights, and how well the patients were cared for because we had a guy like Joe there representing pharmacy and really teaching us, the medical students, the residents, how to be better physicians, to understand the practice of pharmacy. Now, I'm a general vascular surgeon by training, and I subspecialize in trauma, burns, and critical care, and I'm what I would call a recovering surgeon, as many of you know, because if you ask a surgeon to name the best three surgeons in the world, they always have trouble naming the other two. So, being on the surgical service with Joe, you never got too far ahead of your ego because it was humbling, because every day we learn new things. Every day he taught us how to better care for our patients and understand all of the things we're talking about today in polypharm and, you know, simple things and complex things over the years. But because of that experience, as I traversed my life and moved through the academic food chain and became a professor and traveled and then ultimately became Surgeon General of the United States, I never was far from my pharmacy leaders. And one of them you have here today, the Chief Pharmacist of the U.S. Public Health Service, Pam Schweitzer, who is also an alumni And we were here at the same time back when we were both children. I have not aged as well as she has, but and Pam worked for me for many years when I was Surgeon General of the United States, and the country is certainly gifted to have leaders like this, because the pharmacists in the U.S. Public Health Service do far more than just be pharmacists. They serve all over the world. They are assignments that you wouldn't typically think about for a pharmacist, like in Katrina, like in tsunamis in Indonesia. They deployed to the combat zone in Afghanistan and Iraq. The first pharmacy in the combat zone was set up by a young pharmacist who pleaded with me to send her because she wanted to serve her country in a different way. And she did an extraordinary job. Over the years, I've stayed very close with the various pharmaceutical associations and Big Pharma. And again, I will go back to what Joe taught me early on as we were kids, the importance of pharmacy in our lives every day, but also the fact that we all have the privilege to serve and care for our fellow citizens called patients, and none of us is more important than anyone else. So understanding that it really is a team approach, and Joe brought that to us years ago. He was there all the time, even when it was not politically correct. Joe would speak his piece, and these are the lessons that I got from UCSF, as I was just saying to Dan today. One of the best decisions that I ever made was coming here, because this is like the epicenter of health and science. It is the most extraordinary place. And my class reunion today is 35 years, and I am more committed to UCSF today than I ever was as an advocate, because it's such an extraordinary place. And one that, talking to Dan, we need to do a lot more to make sure our students keep coming here, because it's expensive to live here, tuition is high. And yet, as I said to Dan just a few minutes ago, my medical school cost me less than $1,000 a year to get the best education ever in the history of this nation. So, in closing, Joe, I'm so proud of you to be a friend, to see all you've accomplished, and now your leadership within pharmacy. I'm still working a lot, as you know, with pharmacy, looking at expanded scope of practice with various, the American Pharmaceutical Association and a few others, and looking at, from my standpoint as Surgeon General, how pharmacists can be used in a much wider array of public health functions, because after all, you contact patients far more than we do. And so I see, as the world gets more complex and as our workforce challenges continue, I see the pharmacist as really an unleveraged asset that can do so much more in our communities, from community pharmacy to the medical or health home, and just counseling on an everyday basis for all of these things, because the disease and economic burden we have before us today is extraordinary. We're spending almost $3 trillion a year, 75 cents of each dollar spent on chronic diseases, and yet pharmacists have interactions every day where they don't have the time. We need to give them the time to be able to spend time with patients, to give that good counseling, not only for the drugs, but really about health and wellness and the pursuit of optimal health and wellness. Otherwise, it makes no difference what system we put in place, Affordable Care Act or otherwise, the cost curve will go up and we're going to be buried by it. But I think the pharmacists play a very big role in that. And I thank you all for your commitment, and Joe, for your leadership, and that all that the pharmacists have done, but what I hope they will be able to do to help the nation pursue optimal health and wellness. Thank you all very much.
That was really nice. Thank you. Thank you, Rich. So with that stunning introductory remarks, I now would like to introduce today's moderator and long-term UCSF enthusiast, Ian Pearson.
Thank you, Dean. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and congratulations. 143 years. It's an honor for me to join you today in celebrating the history of this School of Pharmacy and celebrating its future, too. For 25 years, I've been providing communication services to about 100 clients nationwide, including and especially UCSF. My work here has ranged from moderating wellness symposiums to producing upwards of 140 videos, including videos of every UCSF medal recipient over the last 20 years. During that time, too, I wore another hat here at UCSF, patient parent. My daughter was born needing 14 years of surgery here. Today, she's a happy young attorney specializing in public health. And as her dad, I want to thank every one of you for all that you do to make UCSF great. We've got a very exciting story for you this afternoon. How two rented offices on Montgomery Street grew into what is today arguably the greatest school of pharmacy in the nation. No? As my daughter would say, what's with that? Well, let's take a look.
San Francisco in 1872. Telegraph Hill was an empty hill. Cable cars were still a year off, and the California College of Pharmacy was born. Renting two rooms in a building later owned by celebrity attorney Melvin Belli. A year later, the college affiliated with the University of California. For the first few years, the professors worked free. Of the first 27 students, only one, John Heaney, showed up for the final exercises and graduated in 1874. For a time, the lectures were held in the summer months when the weather enabled the botany professor to give demonstrations in the field. In 1884, Josephine Barbat became the school's first female graduate and then made history again as its first female faculty member. Meanwhile, donors helped the college buy a new home on Fulton Street, and in 1897, leaders laid a cornerstone on Parnassus. In 1912, the opening lecture was on the drug opium. Students poked fun at the endless drug names to be memorized. And as late as 1925, the curriculum still included Latin, mathematics, and bookkeeping. But none of this could explain what happened next. Three bold initiatives that would advance the entire field of pharmacy. Beginning in the late 1930s, under successive deans, Carl Schmidt and Troy Daniels, the school bucked conventional wisdom by expanding the role of the sciences. In the 1960s, Dean Jerry Goyen greenlighted a small pilot project with historic implications, adding pharmacists to the medical teams on patient floors. And as 1970 dawned, the pharmacy curriculum itself was dramatically overhauled. A PharmD residency program made its debut. Together, these disruptions produced not just headlines, but results no one could have predicted. That experiment, putting UCSF pharmacists on the patient floors, ushered in a new era for pharmacy, one focused on patients instead of products alone. The school's researchers pioneered fields from molecular docking to pharmacokinetics, and today they're creating everything from artificial kidneys to designer molecules that control biological behavior. Because of its research acumen, the School of Pharmacy has received more NIH funding than any other school in the country every year for more than 30 years. Today, the school's PharmD degree program is number one in the nation, even as it continues to evolve. Making history by leading change, the UCSF School of Pharmacy.
But here's the question. Every institution wants to lead. How did this School of Pharmacy pull it off? And where are they directing that innovative energy today and into the future? Well, to answer those questions, this afternoon we've prepared a series of brief conversations with leaders of the School of Pharmacy. Our first guest is...
Excuse me.
We're in a program here. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry, but Miss...
Excuse me.
You're interrupting.
I am here to prepare my students for their final exam. There's my classroom. Where are my students? And who are these people, and why are they dressed so funny?
Miss, this is the year 2015. These are pharmacy alumni. And you look a lot like Josephine Barbat, that first female graduate and instructor from the College of Pharmacy. No?
Sir, I am Josephine Barbat, class of 84. That would be 1884. And are you telling me this is 2015? And these are pharmacists from the next millennium? Oh my. Well, I was here to prepare my students for their exam, and as I said, I have the preparation right here. And I've often wondered how the next millennium, oh my gosh, a pharmacist would fare. So if it's okay with you, Might I ask them some questions from a very old examination? Is that all right with you? You may help me with my cape. Thank you. Okay, so this was from a very old examination from, years ago. And as I used to do, I will ask a question, and then I will randomly select a student to answer the question. These I have selected are the easy ones. Okay, first, where and by what plant is rhubarb produced? Okay, perhaps I should repeat the question. Where and by what plant is rhubarb produced? Let's be polite. The young woman in the back there, yes, right here, right here. No, don't turn around. I'm talking to you. Yes, Miss Wong, I believe. Could you please stand up and identify yourself? Don't dawdle. The answer is? Okay, please sit down. Okay, the second question is, describe the process for making ammoniated mercury. Ammoniated mercury, the process, please. The gentleman there with the blue shirt, yes, on the aisle, yes, you. Stand up, please. Yes? Can you answer that question? Oh, well, I didn't pick you. I picked him, but I doubt that he could answer it either. Thank you. Okay, and lastly, what percent of morphase should a sample of opium contain? Okay, how about you, third young woman in there? Next to the blonde, the attractive blonde. Yes, could you stand up and identify yourself? Oh, sit down. God gave us two ears. Well, I am somewhat disappointed with this group, I must say. And the magic word for the rest of you is continuing education. Continuing education, please study.
Ms. Barbette, would you stay for the rest of the program? I think you discovered that this School of Pharmacy has indeed progressed beyond the time when you were here.
Well, I would be delighted, and I do have the time.
Excellent, thank you.
Thank you.
Take a seat. Well, as our distinguished guest would suggest, this School of Pharmacy has never wanted for colorful characters and capers. Take 1912. That year on opening day, the seniors corralled all of the 1913 undergrads down in the basement and painted big white 13s across their tummies. Welcome to pharmacy. But then fast forward to the 1940s, and School of Pharmacy revelry had turned downright sedate. But then came the 1980s and karaoke, and as you can see, it was a skill set mastered by two future deans. What about today? Well, we'll show you. And even if you don't understand the lyrics, you're going to have to admit that these days, pharmacy's got style.
Got pharmacy style. Pharmacy style. I go to UCSF, my white coat's meant to impress. I had my brain filled in class with pharmacokinetics. Caution, this song's infectious, prophylax with cephalexin. Beta-lactams are time-dependent, take with food, don't skip your breakfast. check this. 2013, yeah, I'm a P4. Learning my meds like never before. PKG, hit the record, cause I'm good for your heart like take a green lore. Hey, lady, yeah. You wanna see me draw a seat a minute then? Lady, yeah. Pay attention, I think you need your
real. Know the doses and stay focused. I'm feeling stiff, I'm doing it. I'll check your INR, not too much warfarin. No DDI, but PPI. Pharmacy style, yeah, 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 yeah. Pharmacy style. Pharmacy style, yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's just an appetizer. Here to tell you more about the colorful history of this School of Pharmacy is historian extraordinaire, Bob Day. Bob. Thank you. Welcome. Thanks for joining us. Let's start at the beginning. The founding fathers back in the 1870s, 1870, if you will, you've read up on them. What impressed you about those gentlemen?
Well, I mean, in order to understand the founders, you have to understand the brew from which they sprang, which was the city of San Francisco. And at that time, it was a city of 150,000 people. We're talking 1869. It had actually grown from a small 13,000 just 20 years earlier before the gold rush. So it was a city of different accents, different dialects, different nationalities, and different kinds of people, perhaps set in the mold for the way that California was to grow over the whole centuries. Walking down Market Street would be like walking through Babylon. Everybody was speaking a different language because they'd all been drawn here by the gold rush. Some of them never left. The people who founded our school were part of that group. They were innovators, they were risk takers, they were just a little bit of everything that we needed at that time to begin what would become the School of Pharmacy. These men, including a guy named J.B. Steele, William Searby, Franklin, not Franklin, Wendell, God, I'm sorry, I'm fucking have to look at my notes. William Wenzel, along with eight others, came together in the back of Steele's Pharmacy, which was actually about five blocks from here. It was at 721 Montgomery Street in 1869, and they wanted to do something. What had happened is there were 71 pharmacies in San Francisco, all of them totally uncontrolled, most of them employing people who didn't know what they were doing. And they felt that standards of pharmacy practice needed to be established, needed to be improved. These men would eventually create what became known as the California State Board of Pharmacy. They created the California Pharmaceutical Society, which became CPHA. And most importantly, in order to improve the standards of the practice of pharmacy, they created the California College of Pharmacy, which was our predecessor, became us. So these were the guys who, over the years, then recruited other people like them. You've heard that we lived at 113 Fulton Street at one point in time. That building was destroyed in the 1906 earthquake, but something nice came up in its place. If you want to visit our old School of Pharmacy, just walk up the steps of City Hall and stop about 20 feet inside. That's where the School of Pharmacy building stood at that time. Then we came to Parnassus, the Parnassus Ledge, in 1898. But before we did that, these men, innovative, decided that they just couldn't build a new School of Pharmacy. They had to know what other schools were doing. So they sent a team of faculty off on a two-month tour of the Eastern Schools of Pharmacy, picking up from them their buildings, their facades, their laboratories, their facilities, and also some ideas for their curriculum, and indeed what to charge for fees. Some of them they really liked. Some of them they thought were a pile of crap, and they said so in their report. You'd be amazed at some of the big-name schools of pharmacy who didn't come through very nicely in the report that they prepared.
Oh, please name them. Time does not permit.
I can't do that because I know too many of the faculty. But in this report of this visit came the very first statement of this crew, of the school that is actually we can actually point to as the beginning of our knowledge in terms of the importance of science. What they said was, we've got to build the finest science laboratories in the nation in this new facility, and we've got to set the mode not only for today, but for the entire future. And that's the earliest statement that the school was committing itself to science, which, as you have heard earlier in the program, or in an earlier program, was what the school has done best at all of these years.
leaders from the beginning. Let's hit a few of the stories that have gone down in the School of Pharmacy's lore. So many beloved faculty, but I'll just pick one. Frank Goyen. What made Frank Goyen so special?
For those of you who never knew Frank Goyen, it's a shame, because although we all have our beloved faculty members, and I'm sure that you had some from your generation, whenever it was, the people in this room that knew Frank Goyen knew a very incredible man. Can I see a show of hands of people who knew Frank Goyen? I think most of you would agree that Frank was a teddy bear of a guy, okay? Roly-poly, kind of like cudgy-pudgy sort of piece and person who loved students because he was single. He never had a family of his own. He adopted the student body. He was daddy. You called him Uncle Frank at the time. He would walk down the halls, his arms loaded with pizzas at midnight or at 10 o'clock or at 9 o'clock. He would invite you out to his house for Thanksgiving dinner. He had, when he became the dean of students, a checkbook on his desk that was pre-signed. And the secretary had instruction, any student comes by for any reason, needs any money, let the student write his own check, pre-signed checks. Did he get the money back? He actually did, every penny. But that's an example of the generosity of this man. So generous that a couple of our alumni have sponsored the Frank Goyen Scholarship ever since his death. They loved him so much, and they were actually his students.
Bob, I recall that at one time the school was making some very unorthodox decisions about awarding degrees, no?
Yeah, they were. Actually, I think we wouldn't consider the PharmD degree one of its inordinate steps, since it was, unfortunately, I hate to say, the second in the nation. You all know that, don't you, to get the PharmD degree? And the only reason we got beat out is because USC didn't have our ponderous bureaucracy. We had to fight it all the way up through the university. USC said, we want a PharmD degree, and they had it the next day. So that's why they're the oldest. You beat us by a year. But anyway, getting back to your stuff. Getting back to your story, let's jump back to 1901 in May. A couple of students have decided they want to stick around longer than the two-year curriculum we had at that time, and the faculty said, well, what should we do for these guys? We just can't have them come. They have to get a degree of some kind. And so what they agreed was that they would give them a doctorate degree. They called it the PD degree, pharmacy doctor degree. Everybody thought that was a great idea. A little bit less than a year later, it was time to consider graduation for these students, and it was time to award them the degrees, but just as they were about to do that, somebody in the faculty realized that they were about to give a degree higher than most of them had. And that just didn't seem right, to award a degree higher than any of you had. So they remedied the situation by taking a second vote, this time to award the degree to themselves. Then they went on and awarded the two degrees, but 3 months later, the university came down like a thud on the university, on our school. It said, you just can't do that, guys. You can't create doctorate degrees. So they had to withdraw from the field, and the PD, or the PharmD, didn't raise its head for another 50 or so years. Should say, however, that the two guys that got the PD degree went through life bearing it. They weren't going to have anything to do with the fact that it was no longer a bona fide degree.
I understand that there was a time when the school was involved in a serious clash with another school on campus over, surprise, surprise, territory. Is that so?
Yeah, it was, and it was a unique, and it probably very painful event if you happen to be a member of the faculty, or particularly the dean at that time, who was William Searby, one of the founders of the school, whose picture you will see popping up on the screen from time to time. Dean Searby was meeting with the president of the University of California in Berkeley. His name was Benjamin Ide Wheeler. Anybody went to Berkeley knows about Wheeler Hall. That was named after that president. Over a budgetary matter, at the end of the meeting, almost as an afterthought, President Wheeler said, hey, do you have any extra space? The School of Dentistry could use some. If you know what it is to be a dean and in control of space, you are always very cautious about admitting that you have too much. So what he said at that time was, well, yeah, we have a closet. It's a small closet. And President Wheeler said, fine, what I'm going to do is send an inspection team over in a couple of days, and we can check it out, okay? They did that. And later, the dean reported to the faculty that that he escorted a guy who's the president's representative and the dean of the School of Dentistry, who at that time was Gaius Milberry, around, and it became obvious that they didn't want the closet they wanted, and it says in quotation marks in very stark letters, our lecture hall. So the dean of the School of Pharmacy was suddenly found itself engaged in a battle over whether or not it had the authority to keep the lecture hall, and it felt it did. So in the next day or so, when a letter arrived from Benjamin Ide Wheeler saying, Thank you for agreeing to give the School of Dentistry your lecture hall. We will soon talk about where to carve up the walls so the School of Dentistry can have access to it. Searby sat down and wrote a letter to him saying, I'm sorry you had the idea that I agreed to anything. I didn't agree to that. And I cannot permit this to happen. The School of Pharmacy cannot afford to lose its lecture hall. He made the mistake of going away on a vacation. When he came back in 2 months, unfortunately, the construction had already begun on the laboratory, and a letter was awaiting him he would have read had he been there, which said basically, sorry, guy, you lose. I'm the president. School of Dentistry gets the territory. Now, the story should have ended here, but it doesn't. That was in 1905. In 1910, and the School of Pharmacy has a long memory of resentment, okay? One of the new deans was wandering in the gardens, and he discovered that a water faucet watering the dental school garden was connected to a School of Pharmacy main. So he ordered the faucet capped immediately and had the secretary send a bill to the School of Dentistry for the water that had been used watering their gardens. He went a step further and made certain that none of our gas lines had been bifurcated the same way. No gas lines had. Now, something good did come out of this because there was a message that was passed down unconsciously from generation to generation of deans, and that was, if the president of the University of California or the chancellor asks if you have any available space, the answer is, no, sir, not even a small closet.
You know, you look at how successful this school is today, it's hard to believe that in the early years, there was a glitch that could have been devastating, you told me. What was that?
Well, it turns out that after our first year, the school had collected a considerable amount of money on the basis of stock certificates it had sold. And it had turned those over to a kind of like a treasurer. They called him a secretary. His name was J. Winchell Forbes. But somewhere along the line, they got the idea that Forbes was living a little bit more richly than he should be. And they discovered, and they did an audit, that $936 was missing from the school's funds. Now, that doesn't sound like a whole lot of money, but let me tell you, in today's dollars, that's $19,000. That's what it would have been worth in those days. And it was devastating because the School of Pharmacy, that was its marginal, it needed that margin to survive. And it would not have survived that particular episode had not the faculty, for the first time then, agreed to work for free, and they did it for 3 years. They did it a second time after the 1906 earthquake. They did it a fourth time during World War II when the student body fell down so low in number that we couldn't afford to pay the faculty. So they took voluntary space cuts. Forbes, what happened to him? It's really not clear. We just know that he was forced to resign, but he ended up in Iowa. Popped up in Iowa. He was very famous in pharmacy circles there. Evidently, the so-called embezzlement, whatever it was, didn't follow him that far. And he wrote about 6 or 8 different songs, some of them military marches.
How about Brother, Can You Spare a Dime? I love this story you told, that there's something you termed the tombstones on the 9th floor.
Yes.
Well, do tell.
Well, if you were to visit the 9th floor of the School of Pharmacy, you would notice that in the walls, there are 2 gigantic plaques. They're, in fact, like 4x5, made out of granite. They're about 2 inches thick. They must weigh about 500 pounds apiece. And they're dedicated to 2 different members of the faculty, William Searby, the former dean, and William Wenzel, one of our founders. He was one of the guys, in fact, he was the guy that brought up the topic of starting the School of Pharmacy in the first place. The story behind it is the following. The dean at that time was Troy C. Daniels. His son is, as you know, sitting in the audience here, so I'm a little reluctant to tell this story. The story that I heard, actually from the secretary who was involved in it, was that one day she went to Dean Daniels and said, guess what, I've discovered a mystery fund, and it's dedicated to buying plaques for these 2 members of the faculty. I don't know who they are, but they died a long time ago. And they've had a bank account in this name, and it was started by the Alumni Association shortly after their deaths in 1909 and 1913, and it was to buy memorial plaques. What should I do with it? Should we just sort of erase it? The dean said, no, let's carry through the wishes of the donors. Let's have the plaques made. And so she said, well, how much should I spend? He said, well, just do the entire fund, whatever the heck it is. And she did. Unfortunately, that little amount of money, whatever it was, had grown immensely. And when the plaques were delivered, what he thought were going to be like one by ones with William Wenzel's name on it were 4x5 marble plaques that looked like tombstones. And they weighed about 500 pounds a piece, as I said.
That's 4x5 feet.
4x5 feet, yes. And so he had them installed in the shaft, next to the shaft in the elevator there, which if you go there today, you will see them. William Wenzel, famous faculty member, and William Searby as well. And I've often referred to them as the tombstones, just as my own little joke. When people ask me what this is, I said, well, these are the former people who are in big time in the School of Pharmacy. They're buried in the wall.
You can tell he could go on all day and it would just get better. One last question for you. And for this, I'm going to need some help from the world-renowned UCSF Glee Club, please. Take it away, folks.
Give me a hand with hair. Long, beautiful hair. Shining, gleaming, streaming, waxing, waxing.
Bob, we've prepared a collage behind you of men in pharmacy over the decades. And my only question is, what's with all the facial hair?
Well, I can explain at least one of the guys in that picture, okay? If you look at it, this is me. And I have this malady known as drifting scalp syndrome. These other guys have no excuse whatsoever.
You've been great, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Day. Thank you. Historian extraordinaire. Next, we're going to talk about the research. Specifically, what happened at this school of pharmacy to turn it into a research leader? Well, 20 years ago, I interviewed former Dean Jerry Goyen about this, and he singled out one key quality.
It's amazing how many things happen at UCSF that I think are kind of unique. People working across school lines, department lines, and doing it with no real difficulty. You don't see that in most institutions.
And that's just part of the story. Here with the rest of the story are two of pharmacy's finest, researchers Les Bennett and Tack Kuntz. Gentlemen. Good to see you. Welcome, welcome. Good to see you. Well, you two would know, the ascendancy of science in the School of Pharmacy, where do you trace its origins? When did it really take off?
I put that to when Les got here.
That's right.
This is the surgeon problem. No, I think really you could pick a lot of starting points, and we've heard some of them. For example, the idea that research should be important. I know it goes back to Troy, and maybe further than that, but you've got to have the idea and the timing. And the timing coincided with a lot of new positions here. And I think you put those two thoughts together and you get a real good start on things.
Yeah, I certainly agree, Tack. But I attribute Troy Daniels, whose son is here, because Troy believed that you needed to bring outstanding scientists that weren't necessarily pharmacists to bring science into the field at the cutting edge. And he did, and that was very unusual in those days for schools of pharmacy to have faculty members like Frank Goen and others who were not pharmacists. And to create an environment at UCSF where the scientists in the School of Pharmacy matched the ability of the scientists in the other schools, that was really important.
Let us drill down a little bit into that. Many schools of pharmacy have wanted to be leaders in science. Why did UCSF succeed?
Well, I'll go back to Jerry's point because I've been here as a faculty member since 1969, and it is the most interactive and integrated campus of any school in the university system in the United States. I can tell my graduate students, my postdocs, they can go into any lab and talk to them and say, I need your help, and they will help. And the same thing happens with us. This is really unusual, but it is the system that works at UCSF and has been of great benefit to us.
And there are stories, and some of you will know these, of very illustrious places, the Harvard level, where a faculty advisor will literally say, you cannot go to a group meeting outside your group. I will not permit it. You have to leave the group. And that would just be so antithetical to the philosophy here. In fact, it was a quote in one of the early slides that went by, "The day of splendid isolation has gone," and I think we seized on that notion. But beyond that, you know, we had fearless deans, and I really mean that. They weren't afraid to hire people way outside their fields of expertise as long as they could see how it could come back to a broad healthcare mission in the end. And I think that took enormous courage on their part.
Let me give just some examples of my own work. When I came here, Izzy Edelman in the School of Medicine, a very famous biochemist in those days, found out I was interested in membranes and invited me to come to his research group meetings and to participate with him. I wanted to carry out some studies in monkeys where I wanted to put a Thomas cannula, and I got Larry Way, who was the chief of GI surgery, to do that surgery. He had never operated on a monkey before, but so I take credit for that in terms of.
And I was here at a time when there was really very little computing. The only computer we had on this campus was a remote access to a machine at Berkeley. And I proposed to our chairman bringing in a quantum chemist. And his first comment to me was, why would we do that? A perfectly legitimate question. But when it was put to Jerry Goyen, he said, well, bring him out, let's meet him. And thus, Peter Coleman had huge opportunities here to apply brand new ideas to all kinds of molecular systems. So that idea, just bring them out, let them prove themselves, was phenomenal.
You know, you mentioned how prescient the deans were in understanding the importance of science. I find this hard to believe, but I understand that in the early days, the profession itself was resistant to what UCSF was trying to do in boosting the presence of science in the School of Pharmacy. Is that so?
I would say the profession was concerned that pharmacists were not being trained by pharmacists. And so I think this was, in fact, in terms of the accreditation agency, actually raised this as an issue when I first got here. But there's one other thing I'd like to say. It was not only the deans, and I think Jerry Goyen really did this. Jerry made the department chairs have the opportunity to build their departments.
Yes.
And it wasn't the dean being controlling. So the department chairs and the faculty had the ability to make the advances and to generate the funds. We actually got very few funds. I was a department chair for 20 years. Our funds did not come from the dean. The funds came from what we were able to generate. And that really made an increase in our ability to interact across campus.
I'm going to give Jerry another shout out too. He made it very clear to me, for example, I came from a conventional chemistry department, that one of my major jobs was to teach effectively. He said, I don't really care what's in the curriculum per se, but the students have to learn about the excitement of whatever it is you're teaching. I happen to do, as Pam knows, physical chemistry. It was not the most popular course, but at least five people have come up to me today to say, well, but at least you did a good job teaching.
You two are not only champions of science at UCSF and have proven it, but you've gone the extra step and spend a lot of your efforts in your careers exporting it. I think less of you and your organizational leadership outside of UCSF, tech and exporting molecular docking and your technology. Why go that extra mile and export?
Well, you know, sometimes you don't have a choice. People come to you. And in particular, in the sense of copying is the most sincere form of flattery, Richard Lerner, who was CEO, I guess, at Scripps, came up here around 1990, sat down with half a dozen of us and said, I want Scripps to be like UCSF. What do I have to do? And among other things, we gave him a list of people to hire. None of our faculty left.
Well, I think the exporting is really important. You really want to take what you develop here and make it be a worldwide and at least nationwide. We created pharmaceutical sciences as an organization and became pharmaceutical scientists. People didn't call us pharmaceutical scientists until the mid-1980s, where it became a discipline. And so you wanted to say, here's what you can do. Here's how you can interact. You don't have to be in pharmacy to be a pharmaceutical scientist. And let's work across boundaries, because that's what has been so successful at UCSF. And so I think we pushed that out. We trained many students, many postdocs, and some of our own faculty who went elsewhere and became deans elsewhere.
And we were really drawing outstanding young people here because of this. So part of the export, as Les just alluded to, is sending out these students into the world after their training. And guess what? They know something that works, and with some improvements on occasion, but many people picked up the model that way.
Yeah, it's really an advantage to be a faculty member at UCSF. And I always say, I really don't need to know anything. Because the students, it's so hard to get in here, and they're so good. So they come and say, I'd like to work in your lab. You say, yeah, yeah. Okay, go do something and make me famous. and they do, you know.
The pressure's on. Last question, and have some fun with this. Look in the crystal ball, both of you, and tell me what you see for the future of science in the School of Pharmacy here.
Well, Les is going to let me go first, because he has a good comeback line. I'm going to pick a particular paper, which I'm sure all of you saw. It comes from Matt Jacobson's lab, among others. It was in Nature last year. And I think I've got the title here, Discovery of New Enzymes in Metabolic Pathways. Now, what makes this remarkable, first of all, three of our faculty are on it as authors. And they build on the work of at least five other faculty members. And what they do is to go get one of these shotgun DNA experiments from some marine organism, and they are able, just from the DNA sequences and computation, to predict not only the function of an enzyme, but the whole pathway in which it exists. Now, you may say this is a long way from pharmacy of today. It is. It's not so far from pharmacy in the future. First of all, there are as many bacterial cells in each of us as there are human cells. In fact, there are 10 times more, I think. So what our bacteria do is what we are. But beyond that, it's this notion that each of us is an individual coming up, personalized medicine you all know about, and we'll be able to read out everything that you need to know to be therapeutically efficient. The doctor won't say to you, or the pharmacist won't say to you, how are you feeling? They'll say, oh, we have the test results. Let me tell you how you feel. So I see this as coming right down the road. Les.
Well, that's okay. So tax change, he said I'm going to say something different. So precision medicine is, you know, the byword today, but it's actually going to be old hat. It's going to be old hat in just a few years, because the science is going to progress so far beyond what Tack just said, and we're going to move into areas that we haven't thought about. In 1983, I did a sabbatical in Tübingen, Germany, and Herbert Remmer, who was the P450 maven at that time, we spent half of our time talking about, is there one P450 or two P450s? We didn't know anything about transporters until the 90s, and now we spend all our time talking about transporters. So there's lots of stuff out there that we haven't yet discovered that is going to change our entire approach about how we do things, and the wonderful thing is being at UCSF to interact with the kinds of people who will make those jumps in the future.
I absolutely agree.
You two have been wonderful. Ladies and gentlemen, Les Bennett and Tack Kuntz, thank you. Here's a question for you. If history happened around you, would you be able to spot it? I mean, sometimes history can trick us. Sometimes it's just disguised as a bunch of 20-somethings wandering a hallway. But this is the famous ninth-floor pilot project. the experiment to move pharmacists up onto the patient floors. It was meant to be an experiment that folded after 9 months, but instead it catapulted pharmacists into the future of patient care. What on earth happened? Well, here to make sense of this most unlikely revolution is one of its pioneers, UCSF's own Toby Herfindahl. Toby. I can't believe this, but you told me that as the ninth floor project started, all of you involved really didn't have a grand vision. You were just trying to deal with a couple of problems.
Well, let me clarify something. The five people that were there at the very beginning, I think three of them are in the room, and I'm going to introduce them. I'll take the liberty.
Please.
Of doing that. Bill Smith, could you stand up? He was the leader of the team that really implemented the ninth floor project. Rich DeLeon, stand up, please. Joe Hirschman, are you in here? There's Joe.
There you go.
There were two others. One is not here right now. His name is Bob Miller. And the other one passed away, unfortunately, a couple of years ago, Don Holston, who was very critical to the unit. I joined it about a year after the program started. But to answer your question, was there a grand scheme? To a certain extent, there was a strategy. They had goals, they had objectives, they had to, you know, justify this. But most of it had to do with fixing a terrible drug distribution system in the hospital.
It was the nurses who brought that to your attention.
And, well, the hospital was going through some changes. They wanted to change how they delivered care on the floors. They implemented a manager, a CEO of a floor. His name was Chuck, I think, Rich, wasn't it? And they carpeted the place. In the past, there was just this ugly green tile. And, you know, they really spiffed the place up. They changed how they did things. They wanted to make it more efficient. But the thing that they hadn't fixed was this terrible drug distribution system. They had to wait forever to get their drugs. Because they waited forever, they had stashes of drugs sitting around, a very unsafe system. But that became the Trojan horse. That became the reason for us to be there. If you put the pharmacist up on the floor, they could fix that system. And that's really what the thing grew. The fact that we started to go on rounds, that was... The doctors would come and ask us questions, and eventually they would say, well, why don't you go on rounds with us? Participating in Code Blues and all of those things just kind of grew over time, and frankly, it's still growing. None of us, I don't believe, Bill, I've talked to him a lot about this, none of us anticipated where pharmacy is today. The fact that we're shooting to become independent providers, and we have a law in California now that will allow us to get about halfway there, not fully there. But it was just a product of perseverance of some very frustrated individuals. And I'm going to skip ahead in your questions here because I'm on a train of thought. These guys were troublemakers. I've talked to them. I mean, and we were all the same way. Joe was going to go into the Peace Corps. Bob was going to be an attorney. Rich was, I don't know what Rich was going to do, but he was going to do something. Or he was going to teach. He was going to teach. But we were a product of a changed curriculum. They said you're going to be drug experts. And we went out there and we looked. There weren't any jobs for drug experts. So very early on, even in the class of 1964, they developed a video that was called a film in those days, right? called A Turning Point, that really talked about what pharmacists could do, not what pharmacists were doing. And Bill was part of that, and Bob Miller was part of that, Michael Stern was part of that. And that kind of showed the frustration. You know, a lot of people have said you can't achieve anything unless you're frustrated. You've got to be unhappy with the status quo. And these guys were very unhappy with the status quo. And when the opportunity came along to fix this drug distribution system, these guys said, okay, I'll sign up, I'll do that.
you didn't have what you would call these days some grand vision right from the get-go. No. But once the project started humming along, what emerged as some of the things you were observing? I mean,
Well, the big surprise was we sometimes knew what we were talking about. You know, we would express an opinion and then run off and check in the textbook to see if we were right. And so that was a surprise. The other surprise was how accepted we were by the medical staff. Yeah. It was just amazing. I mean, you know, we thought we were kind of sneaking in there, and all of a sudden they say, hey, help me, the attendings would say, help me teach my residents about drugs, because they don't really know anything about drugs. So it really was enlightening. And then we started to have students come with us, and they were inadequately prepared. And one of the things that we did, I think it was in 1969, we had a big faculty retreat. And we gave them the faculty. This was the faculty that had supported us for the ninth floor. They wanted us to do it. When I was hired, I was told I had 9 months worth of funding. Bill Smith, after he left, found out that his salary was all supported by salary savings. It wasn't a real, real solid line item job. And what was very clear, and the message we sent to the faculty, you supported us, the curriculum sucks. And we weren't very good at candy coating it. We were not good at that. The faculty was very angry, I remember, at that retreat. Les was there. I remember seeing you staring at us, frowning. But as a result of it, I really have to admire the faculty. They came back. We changed the curriculum. Jerry Goyen was hugely influential behind the scenes, jawboning, talking to people about, maybe we have too much pharmacognosy, and maybe we have too much organic chemistry, and maybe we can realign some things. We can start to do some joint teaching across the departments. And I really have to attribute Jerry Goyen's ability to work with people to make that happen for us. Yeah. Otherwise, we would have been long gone.
It not only succeeded in spreading across UCSF, but it spread nationwide, mm-hmm. far and fast. Yeah. What helped it to succeed on the national scale?
Well, I think it was very similar to what Tack and Les were talking about. It was not like the corporate world where you hide all your inventions. In academia, you go out and you brag about it. And you travel around, you talk to people about what's going on and what you're doing, and we had literally thousands of visitors that came through the ninth floor. At least half of them were there to see why this was a bad idea. And a lot of pharmacists wanted to, you know, talk to deans and other people who came around and said, well, I don't want to do this. This is not what pharmacy is all about. But then you had other people who were there to learn. So the visitors, the textbooks that were created, we didn't have any therapeutics textbook. So we developed textbooks in therapeutics and pharmacokinetics and pediatrics and a lot of areas that we wrote that were used in colleges of pharmacy all over the world, translated into lots of different languages. Students that trained with us were offered faculty positions straight out of school. They got their PharmD and all of a sudden they're an assistant professor back in Kentucky or someplace. It was amazing. So they became sort of the advocates, the disciples that spread the word. And it was really wonderful to see that happening.
Yeah, so you actually had a lot of graduates of the school who were heading out and being evangelists for it all.
Absolutely, yeah.
It all became a national model. It affects healthcare to this day.
It definitely does. To bring it to today, the Affordable Care Act, all of a sudden you've got millions more patients coming into the system. In California, we're in the middle of changing the pharmacy scope of practice, where pharmacists now, the Board of Pharmacy, the law has been passed, signed by the governor, that allow pharmacists to become providers and get paid for doing a lot of things that physicians and nurse practitioners used to do. California is leading that. And I don't think there's an accident that USC and UCSF developed all of this. We got involved, as did USC back in 1978, and it's something called Assembly Bill 717, which was an experimental program to expand the scope of practice of pharmacists under the supervision of physicians. It was tightly controlled, very limited, but it was a foot in the door. And this year, the governor signed Senate Bill 493, I think it is, which greatly expanded the scope of practice. None of that could have happened if it wasn't for the ninth floor project at UCSF, Med OCHA down at USC, University of Kentucky. We were kind of nip and tuck. We were competing. Most of us believe that we were the epicenter of clinical pharmacy development, and I still believe that.
I think of how close we came to losing you when you were on your way to accept a job from UCSF and had to interview, and boom, you get a flat tire. A weaker man would have turned around and gone home.
I thought it was an omen, yeah. I was on my way from the Central Valley, and halfway down I was in Tracy, and all of a sudden I got a flat tire. And I had an appointment that day with Jerry Goyen and Eric Goyang, and I was thinking, somebody's trying to tell you something. But I was very happy I went through with it. It's the best thing I've ever done.
No kidding. Yeah. First of all, thank you. And I would like a round of applause, not only for you, but for your colleagues, for all of what you did in this area. Congratulations. Thank you. Thank you. Well, at this point in our program, one quality of this School of Pharmacy becomes apparent. This is a place where one great idea can easily lead to another great idea. The ninth floor pilot project established a proof of principle. That in turn led to a new curriculum. That in turn challenged the pharmacy's leaders at the time to recruit a new kind of student. But the question is, would those pharmacy leaders in the 70s be up to the challenge? Well, here's what one of them told me just a few years later.
We were a very intense crowd. We were up there. We were going to change the world as it related to drugs and patients. We were do-gooders. What can I say? We were idealists. We were children of the 60s. So all of those things came together. We wanted to make that contribution to the world, frankly.
Yeah, set your sights low. Here to tell us what happened next is pharmacy education personified, Mary Ann Cota Kimball. Hey, good to see you.
Sit up straight.
Yeah, you got the whole couch to yourself here. Just you came to UCSF the first time, joined here, just about the time the Ninth Floor Project was getting underway. What was the old curriculum like back then?
Well, I think Toby gave you some hint of it. We were to be drug experts, and so many of us experienced it. We had courses in pharmaceutical chemistry, we had physical chemistry, we had pharmacology. So all of these courses, and they were basically kind of black and white courses. You memorize that stuff, you spit it out on the paper. And, you know, we could do that very well. We knew a lot about drugs. So there was no patient contact whatsoever, no interaction with patients, no interaction with physicians, absolutely not. And because they were the ones giving us the orders. And we, you know, we followed those orders, and we didn't really question those orders. So that was the environment in which, so the curriculum was based around that, and that's the way it was.
Then along came the Ninth Floor Project, and everybody started to learn things. How did that change? What changes came in the curriculum?
Well, you know, that's when I saw the light. Somebody said, oh, we could do something for patients. I'm not kidding you, I had a purpose. You know, and I says, I'm gonna be the best clinical pharmacist in the world, right? So did we call ourselves clinical pharmacists? I'm not sure did we? Okay. So we were some of the early ones. We had an opportunity to get up there. And I will say that we were there to prove ourselves, not for ourselves, but to prove that we could add value to patient care. So therefore, you know, what I learned, what I realized is when I would have a student who had a full-blown case of digitoxicity patient in front of her, I would say, what are the symptoms of digitoxicity? Oh, arrhythmias, GI, this and that and the other. I says, what's wrong with this patient? I don't know. Because they didn't, we learned drugs specifically, that drug. We didn't learn about diseases and how drugs from many different classes were used to treat that condition. Furthermore, we didn't know what it looked like if a patient was responding to a drug, and we didn't know what it looked like if a patient had an adverse effect to a drug. We didn't know that that patient had renal failure, and therefore, DIG was accumulating. Well, we knew that fact, but we couldn't see it. So we had to kind of flip the brain around, and that's when we moved to the case study approach to teaching our students.
We saw the soundbite of you back in the day, and you're right, you were a real zealot about it. Was everybody in the School of Pharmacy as enthused as you and
not everybody. First of all, I had faculty, like Joe said, these guys, these bad guys here, Joe Hirschman, Rich DeLeon, they were there to prove something. And therefore, they could not afford for any of us to be making any mistakes. And I still remember, Joe knows, they started giving us oral examinations. And I still remember the question. Joe says, so what is the dose of aspirin for a kid? What is it? I go, you're a pharmacist and you don't know that? I mean, I felt this high. And therefore, that's the way I taught. I was a mean. One of my teaching evaluations said, who in the hell does she think she is? Standing on a pedestal with her black hip boots and her whip. And true enough, well, you know, we couldn't have students embarrassing ourselves, so we had to teach them up here because the half-life of knowledge went to there, and they had to be brilliant on the floors. So they didn't like us. The students just, I know there were several students who left the profession because of us, I think.
I hesitate to ask this follow-up question. You're not wearing your hip boots, so maybe I'll be okay. The faculty, how did they react?
Which faculty? Well, you know, there was tension, I think, between the basic science faculty, particularly the pharmaceutical chemists, and the clinical faculty who were terrible. You know, we're like Joseph and like Toby said, we weren't nice. We didn't have any political savvy whatsoever. But I will give credit to Sid Riegelman, who was then chair of biopharmaceutical sciences, who literally, Sid Riegelman? Yes. Literally, he gave us half of his faculty position lines. And he gave us a lot of his budget so that we could survive as a division within his department. And I just as an aside, I will say as dean, I gave some of those FTE back to, to the.
we're recording this.
I made that department whole again because they were really suffering they were underfunded and they did not have enough faculty because they had been so generous in the past.
The ninth floor project and the curriculum changes were huge. Talk to me about what the long-term impact of those has been.
Well, first of all, what you have to remember when we began, we were attracting students who wanted to go into a profession where they didn't see blood and they could just hide out in the basement and, you know, they could just take orders and take their work. They didn't have to take their work home with them, right? So we were attracting kind of a passive group of people. And they were people that really didn't want to make decisions. And we know clinically there's no black, there's no white, there's gray. And they were shy. They didn't assert themselves. So here we were giving oral examinations. We were offering conferences where they had to speak up. They had to make decisions. And there were many, many tears along the way. So what we actually had to do was transform our admissions process so that we were attracting students who were leaders, who wanted to be change agents. The thing wasn't out there, and I know I don't think I'm answering your question, but so I think over time we have transformed the way the profession practices because our students have done that. You know, I see our students doing things I would never have imagined. They created it. So we don't teach them, we teach them how to think. We teach them to be change agents. And I'm really kind of proud of that fact. And and as Toby says, they've gone out, they've done these things, and here we are.
You read my mind. I'm going to ask you to stay here. You've been great, but stick with us. I'm going to ask Vice Dean Sharon Yeomans to join us and talk about where the pharmacy curriculum is going in the future, please. Sharon. You mentioned to me that there are three forces that are driving change these days in pharmacy curriculum: the Affordable Care Act, other pending federal legislation, and pending California legislation. How might those change pharmacy and curriculum?
Well, those changes are forcing us to think differently about pharmacy education. Pharmacists now will continue to be full partners in healthcare teams taking care of patients, where the focus is improving patient outcomes. But overall, it's not just patient care. We expect our graduates to be part of research teams, where they'll be contributing to the discovery of new drugs and new therapeutics. We expect them to go out and work in public health, and we have an example coming up later, where they'll be participating in population science and contributing to health policy. So all of these moons and the stars are aligning to really force us to think about pharmacy education differently and how we prepare our graduates to address the needs of the 21st century in terms of healthcare.
I think you may have answered my next question, which was going to be that you are sort of responding to these tumults, the disruption that's coming already in the form of the recruits you're recruiting these days. They're different. They're disruptors in their own right, in a sense.
Correct. The type of student that we're recruiting and accepting in our programs are phenomenal, as Marianne already alluded to. They come from a variety of work experiences, life experience, education experiences. They're super smart. They're much smart. I could not compete with them today. So we need to figure out how to capitalize on that, how to nurture those leadership skills that we see, those people who aren't afraid to take risks to be change agents, the science that they bring in and research experience that they bring in, and then provide an environment where they can continue to demonstrate those skills and really go on to do things not only for today, but also for the future. And the options are just limitless.
As I understand it, you're going to be starting to roll out pilot projects and curriculum, and the whole thing will be in place by 2017?
That's our goal to unroll it, yes.
Some of the courses. What kind of courses will we see?
Well, I can't comment on the courses because we're not there yet. We've taken information and input from our students and our faculty and some of our alums, and I will promise you that the end product will be bold and spicy. We will have more experiential, maybe perhaps less room, less time in the classroom, but as Tack alluded to, we want to have our basic scientists and our clinical scientists to come into the classroom and make their science and research come alive as we're teaching our students the chemical principles of drug therapy. Interprofessional education is going to be very important, partnering in this the long history of our relationship, especially with the School of Medicine, where our students will not just be a group of people in a room talking about a topic, but they'll actually be working on projects, working in perhaps different settings in different hospitals, learning from each other and with each other. And we want to create an environment where we can nurture the entrepreneurial spirit. Business is very important. Not that you have to go out and get your own store, but you need to start thinking. And it's really about thinking, problem solving, being analytical, clear communication, because you can't, you know, anticipate every problem. As if we have to teach our students to be comfortable with the unknown. Who else should I ask to the table that may have a different experience, a different perspective to help me solve a healthcare-related problem?
When the smoke clears on all this, how will it position UCSF? Is UCSF going to be doing what everybody else is doing except way better? or is this going to be very different?
Well, it depends on who you talk to. But we feel that at UCSF, UCSF is a very, very special place. And I feel that we are uniquely positioned being a health science campus and being a campus focused on healthcare. And we are positioned to really produce the best of the best in the world. And I always say for the faculty, we just need to get out of the way of our students and let them go forward. So I see that we will be the leaders in producing these 21st century pharmacists. And we invite all of our stakeholders, our alums, to join us in this conversation and this debate, because things need to change. We want a curriculum that is nimble so that as the needs change, we can easily change. It won't take an act of Congress or a knockdown, drag out fight to change things. And I'm very excited about the future. And we want our students to say that I came to UCSF because what I can get at UCSF, I can't get anywhere else.
Well put. Thank you, Sharon. You've been great. And Marianne, too. But before you two go, remember a minute ago that we did a shout out to pharmacy's men for their facial hair? Well, equal time. I'm going to need some help on this from the world famous UCSF marching band, please. Go ahead. Here they come. This is a shout out to pharmacy's women. Not the facial hair, but plenty of beehive hairdos and baby bumps and plenty of strength and drive. Let's give it up for pharmacy's women. Thank you, Paul. Wonderful. Our final segment this afternoon celebrates one of this School of Pharmacy's most consequential exports, its alumni, which at this School of Pharmacy is synonymous with its leaders. It's been that way since the beginning. This is a photo of the original full graduating class. The man standing on the right is Gaston Bacon. He went on to be president of the board of directors of the College of Pharmacy for 30 years. The man standing on the left is Adolf Kahn. Kahn became president of the Napa Valley Medical Society and then also served as the chief health officer for that county. And it's been that way ever since. You alums just can't help but overachieve. Our next guest is a perfect case in point. Rear Admiral Pam Salas Schweitzer, class of 1987, has not only shot through her public health career like a jolt of electricity, she's the only person I've ever met who's certified as both a pilot and a scuba diver. And sure enough, she's also your 2015 distinguished alumna. Please say hello to Rear Admiral Pam Schweitzer. Let's start with the fun stuff.
It's tough being here with all these folks here.
You're going to do just fine, I think. Speaking of that, I'd die to have your resume, but let's start with the fun stuff. Your time at the School of Pharmacy here. What are the memories?
Well, I thinking about all of that, and Marilyn and I, we've talked about it just because we were on a hike last week. We talked a little bit about that, but I can give you impressions. Of what it was like during pharmacy school. First of all, the faculty, and it's interesting that you say that you wanted the students, it was tough on the students. What I remember and the impressions I had is that the professors, they actually cared about us. They were like, give us a lot of individual attention. They knew each of our names. Everybody, they knew their names. So we knew them all. They cared. They wanted us to do well. They wanted us to learn the material. But probably even more so, all of my colleagues, my classmates, we wanted to learn the material. So we were like passionate about learning it. We actually got into it. It wasn't for the exam. It was we wanted to actually learn the material. So I remember that. I remember going over to Marianne.
What year was that?
I remember going over to your house a few times, Marianne. You had us for dinner. I remember Wilma Wong went over to her house for dinner. So, I mean, they actually cared about us. I remember working a lot in the library, and we got to know all the other disciplines, the dentist. I mean, it seems like I knew a lot of dentists because we'd study together. I don't know where the medical students were. I remember the grad students hanging out with them a lot, too. So I had a lot of really fun memories. And the other thing that probably, for me, it was just like a whole new world because all of a sudden, all these people, we wanted to make a difference in the world. All of us did. And so we were involved in service projects. All we were doing was we'd out there, we'd volunteer for everything. I volunteered for everything I could volunteer for because it was so much fun. We'd be out in the communities. We'd be working with patients doing screenings. So it was really, really a fun time for us. And those are the memories that I have. Oh, and then, of course, I was a Phi Delta Chi. Yeah, all right, good. Phi Delta, I don't know how many are out there. Yeah, Robin, how you doing? And we interacted a lot, like with the classes before us and behind us. So it was like that camaraderie. My impression right now, all of us would say it was so much fun, and we learned a lot at the same time.
You walked out the door with the bowl of Hygieia, and mm-hmm. you probably could have written a ticket to any medical school or institution, university in the United States, but you took jobs in remote areas like South Dakota and Arizona, working for the Indian Health Service and the VA. Why?
Well, it's probably not as noble of a reason. what ended up happening is I got married to my husband. He's not here right now, but you meet him. He's very adventurous, and he's sort of like the opposite of me. I like to work real hard, but he's like fun and play. And so what ended up happening is I already liked the service. He did too. He's kind of like a teacher, so we both like that service. Part of just doing meaningful work. So what ended up happening is we graduated, and there's jobs all over the place. That's actually what it was. Jobs everywhere. We could do anything. Let's travel. Let's go do some service work and go somewhere we've never gone before. And so we, sight unseen, when the position opened up, and it was in the Black Hills. I didn't know what the Black Hills were at the time, but we went. We just went, sight unseen, and we went there. And what happened with us when we went to these remote sites, we're working on a team approach, just like we were trained in pharmacy school. It was all working with the physicians, nursing, side by side. We were equals. We called each other by our first names. We had potlucks together. We get together. Our kids all know each other. So it was an environment where you couldn't tell. All of us were on the team. We filled each other's gaps. And that closeness that you get, you wouldn't get that anywhere else. You know, where everybody's talking first name. There's not any of that hierarchy. So we ended up going there to South Dakota. Then we went to Tuba City, lived on the reservation there. And, of course, everywhere we went, because my husband is so outgoing, we integrated in the community. He would be the volunteer fire department, volunteer police department. Just he was a coach. You know, he did all that stuff. So we would integrate ourselves everywhere, and we just fell in love with those small town and being able to make a difference wherever we went, like the whole family did.
You know, in looking over your body of work, starting with South Dakota and Arizona, it's almost as if the model you were building had the fingerprints of UCSF all over it. You championed education, recruitment, mm-hmm. community outreach, mm-hmm. reorganizing the organization. Were you sort of following a template that you took to the national stage?
You mean in the public health service or in the public health service? Well, here's what happened is when we got out of school, we talked about having clinical programs, and you learn how to get a clinical program off the ground. Remember, we talked about that all the time, getting clinical programs. Well, that same model applies to everything, I'll be honest with you, just influencing change, working with all the people, doing the administrative part. So almost everything I did, as soon as I came out of school, when I went to the Midwest, they didn't have those clinical programs going. So right out of the chute, I had that experience right out of school. All right, let's get them going. You know, and you ask them and they say, you know how to do it? Yeah, I didn't, but I said, yeah. So anyway, I was the expert from UCSF. So I kind of used that a little bit. And so then you got them going, got them off the ground. And the one thing I did do different is we needed to always make them sustainable. So I got smart a little bit. You pick the right people, and you know about this. Pick the right people. Make sure it's sustainable. Make sure it's going to stick, and then I move on to the next implementation. So just over the years, it seems like that's all I've done is implement anything. That same model works across the board for almost anything, and I'm actually doing it right now. Marilyn knows, and so does Robin, because they're in on it. Doing it now, doing the same thing, but at the very, very national level, because a lot of it really comes out down to planting seeds, getting people used to the idea. I mean, you have to start that way, right? You start that planting seeds, getting people used to the idea, doing little, show them little thing. You find out who the decision makers are. You find out who the people that are going to have the influence. You start working on them. They don't know you're working on them. But that whole model works across the board nationwide. So I'm doing it right now.
You make it so sound so easy. Just
well, it actually, after you, it's not that hard, is it?
Pretend like it is.
Pretend like it is.
So you've answered part of my next question, but we know a little bit about what you do now, but mm-hmm. what's on your plate coming up?
Well, I'll tell you even a little bit what I'm doing now, which I haven't really talked totally about. So I have, the way my job works every day is I have two jobs. So my one job is I'm Assistant Surgeon General under the Surgeon General, and that's in the Department of Health and Human Services. And there, that goes down into two separate jobs. One of it is I'm over the other officers throughout the public health service. And so a lot of that is just building them up, doing leadership, making sure they're trained, doing all the things to help their careers, helping them get into the right places, so managing that group. And then besides that, under that Surgeon General office, it's also I'm the point of contact for anything related to pharmacy in the nation. So some of you, I'm looking at here at Robin and Marilyn because they know what I do, and there's initiatives coming out of the White House, and so they need the pharmacy profession to have input on it, or there's some of the departments, they have just requests they need from pharmacy. So I get with all the leaders in the field of pharmacy and I pull those together and get that information. So that's one part. And then the other part is I have my job at CMS, and there I'm busy working on the Affordable Care Act. I work in Medicaid, and I work with all the state Medicaid programs. And this is not pharmacy, this is the Medicaid director. So it's not pharmacy work for me, it's more policy. And the good news is, and this is kind of I'll just tell you, I'm working in an area where all the provider policy areas, I'm in there. And there's only about four of us that are working on that. So I'm just involved in all of that. So I've sort of inserted myself in different places that I'm very interested in. We do meaningful use and high tech and ICD-10 too, but I've kind of inserted places where I'm very interested in.
A couple last questions, but you said that one of the best pieces of advice you got was not at UCSF, but years later from Toby Herfindahl.
Yes, it was. And it was kind of funny because when you're in pharmacy school, you go and you learn all the drugs, and so you get them down cold. And what happened was is, you know, at the time you're learning and memorizing and learning all everything. Well, we get out and like there's a whole, I learned so much more that first year after I got out of pharmacy school because there's all these drugs they didn't even teach us. So this is my attitude. I'm just telling you that was my attitude, is that look at all these drugs that we learn now and they didn't even cover them in pharmacy school. So the first time when I went and saw Toby, I think I saw Toby at a meeting a couple years later, and I went up to him, Toby, you guys muffed up. And when I said that, you know, I'm being kind of cocky telling him this. And I told him that, you know, there's so much we didn't learn. And then he kind of came back with a comment, well, did you figure it out? And I said, yeah, of course I figured it out. And he goes, well, that's what we taught you. So then it just... So it just occurred to me later that that wasn't the purpose of school, to teach us about the drugs. It was to teach us how to learn, because, of course, I knew how to do that all very well. And I'd learned it cold, and I could teach other people how to do it. And so that was the point of it. So I made sure I'd never do that again. I don't say that again anymore. And I tell the students the same thing, too.
Last question. You've been very vocal about considering pharmacists as agents of change. Mm-hmm. Explain.
Well, I think one of the things, and that's a good question, and it was mentioned earlier too, because you talked about agents of change. What ends up happening, and I think somewhere in school, we learn how to influence change, because you have to go, when you're talking to the physicians, this is like when you learn how to do it, how to communicate with administrators, how to communicate with the other health professionals, you have to learn how do you convince them to want to make change? How do you do that? So they want to make the change. So it's not like it's something you're coming down on them for they made a mistake, but how do you get to make them change? I have a friend that he tells me, Pam, when I talk to you, my favorite vanilla ice cream is vanilla ice cream, but you come talk to me and you tell me to take chocolate and I will do it. But it's not really meant to be about that. It's really how do you get them to want to make change? So part of it is you learn that really well along the way because you learn to approach people different ways. You learn how to hit them at this angle, how to hit at that angle. And somehow what ends up happening is you can get people to change without really, you don't even realize you're doing it, but you just, there's probably about 10 different angles you can hit somebody at, and they all may have a different angle. So somewhere along the line, you just get good at that. Wouldn't you agree? Yeah.
you mentioned in embellishing on that when we talked earlier that pharmacists can be role models beyond their 9-to-5 or their 10-to-10 job in their lifestyles as well.
They can be role models. And what I was going to do is one more thing on the change. So I'll just give you an example. Just when I was working, one of the biggest changes I probably made that over the years, because for pharmacists, it was a very different concept. At least in the Indian Health Service, we had to counsel everybody. So all of a sudden now, we had to change the model because we were doing automation. And how are we going to get everybody to change? That was probably the hardest thing, because across the board, we had to get people to start thinking differently and how they use electronic health record. And so that was a lot of planting seeds, because the pharmacist had to do that, and the pharmacist had to work with the providers. So those kind of changes, we got the pharmacist, got them what to say so that they could go make all those changes. So anyway, that takes like a long time. It takes like four or five years. So. Anyway, what was
I think you in talking with me earlier
Public health. Oh, public health. Yeah, well, we have to walk the talk.
Being role models. I mean, be active in the community. Go jogging.
And that's sort of along the line with the Surgeon General. The direction is that we're all in healthcare, and here we are. We need to be examples to everybody. And I will tell you, that is the hardest thing even for me to do, because I have to walk the talk too. There's a lot of bad habits I have, and you have to kind of fix them, but you can do them one at a time. But I actually sort of took it on as a challenge too, because if I can do it, then I can convince my patients to do it too, because that's one of the things we learn. We do motivational interviewing and all these other things, but we have to be able to do that too to ourselves.
Some examples?
Like
changing habits?
Changing habits, like I used to like to drink Diet Pepsi all the time, or pop. Are you a Diet Pepsi drinker? So anyway, or drink pop. And so I only just drink one a day. I mean, I'm just saying that. That's all I drink, one a day. I can stop anytime, but it is so hard to stop. But I've given it up now. I've been about a year or so, and I haven't drank it at all. And I did it because my son. And just little things like that, just making those changes, it's really difficult. So how do we expect our patients to do it and we don't? So just exercising every day. We should be models of health, because that's the way we're trying to move our country towards, is being more healthy. So we need to do the same thing and walk the talk, be active, healthy lifestyles, eat well, drink well, you know, all of that. So
we have a reception in a few minutes, and if I see you in the soda pop line, which I
you won't. No, that's the tough part, is because the tough part, I can't when there's people around. No, I'm just joking.
Pam, I we could go on, but we're out of time, and I am out of questions, and I want to thank you so much, but also congratulate you on what you've done and what I know you're going to do.
Okay,
ladies and gentlemen,
you.
Rear Admiral Pam Schweitzer. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
That about concludes our program. About concludes it. Okay, before we do so, though, I'd like to ask all of our speakers to stand, please. What a stellar crowd. Give them a thank you. You really were terrific.
I want to know the answer to those questions.
You just might get your chance. We've got some closing remarks from Dean Guglielmo.
So first of all, I have to start. I have to personally thank each of you, Pam, Toby, Les, Tack, Bob, Marianne, and Sharon. They were just phenomenal. I could not have been prouder of them in terms of what they showed all of you. And I also have to take a moment to thank Ian Pearson, who was really a remarkable moderator. He also produced the entire video sequence that you saw before the program started, so he's really done it all. So I'm struck, you know, in years past, when a pharmacy alumni association banquet would finish, there would often be a rousing cheer to complete the event. And I don't know, I was just, I just was wondering, would it be possible if Ms. Barbat, would you be willing maybe to come up here and maybe lead this very young group in a cheer of some sort? I'm just wondering.
Oh, with pleasure, with pleasure. And I just want to say thank you so much for inviting me to stay. My heart is just so warm and overwhelmed with the alumni that came after me. Thank you so much. And young man, could you come up here with me?
You said young?
Yes, yes. Okay, well, what we're going to do, I love this cheer. We're going to do a cheer from yesteryear. Okay, so you stay here. And first we're going to do this very slowly, okay? And enunciate, please. And then we'll do it really with a lot of gusto, okay? Okay, so all together. Ipecac opium tansi-T.
California College of Pharmacy.
Oh, rah! Okay, now, here we go, here we go. Loud and clear, go. Ipecac, opium, tansi-T. California College of Pharmacy. Oh, bravo, bravo.
So this is going to stun several of you, but that really wasn't Josephine Barbat. That is the one and only Lori Rice, past associate dean of the School of Pharmacy, a wonderful friend and colleague. Thank you. So I want to acknowledge just a few more guests, and then we'll enjoy the reception afterwards. But you heard a number of comments. And you also saw a number of snapshots before we started the seminar. And you saw two deans highlighted, and that was Dean Carl Schmidt and Dean Troy Daniels. And you heard some of the research folks talk about it. And if you had to say, what did these gentlemen bring particularly to the School of Pharmacy? I guess the word research comes to my mind, and real science coming alive when, in fact, it had not been integral to the School of Pharmacy. I know that in the case of Dean Schmidt, he actually was the dean that actually came to the conclusion that maybe, just maybe, faculty should get grants. So this is where, talk about a moment in time, this was a moment in time when, in fact, that took place. Dean Daniels, who was dean for longer than any dean I think I know in health services anywhere, you heard in his case, he was the one that said, you know what, there's another thing here, and that is we actually should have PhDs with our faculty who are teaching in the school, something that did not exactly go over well initially. So two spectacular deans that in many respects were a team. I'm going to talk about Eddie Way in a moment, but Eddie Way, in a video, said something, and he said it beautifully. He says, you know, and he didn't talk about his Dean Daniels or Dean Schmidt. He goes, Schmitty and Troy, he goes, they were quite a team. And he said, Schmitty knew all the details and how you get through the University of California system, and Troy had the idea and the spunk to move this stuff forward, but they were a wonderful team. Those were Eddie's words. And today, we are, in fact, blessed to have, first of all, in terms of Dean Carl Schmidt, we have his son, Al Schmidt, who is here before me, who makes one of the meanest root beer floats I know. I enjoy it with him a couple times a year. And then Dean Schmidt's grandson, and that's Bill Schmidt, who is an alumnus, a PhD alumnus from the graduate division. And then to Al's right, we have Troy Daniels. Troy, the son of the distinguished Dean Troy Daniels. And you heard Troy, and you know this, anybody that's been around UCSF, Troy has been absolutely a cornerstone to the School of Dentistry for years and years. I do want to ask if there's still bad blood over the turning off the water thing between the School of Pharmacy and the School of Dentistry. And then we have Leslie Daniels. And Leslie, for those of you who don't know, Leslie is the daughter of the esteemed alumnus Harry Hind. So we are indeed fortunate to have these spectacular guests here to remind us of the legacy of those particular deans. I always have to point out Eddie Way, who is sitting right there, dressed to kill, as always. He's got that hat on. He's got it all going on. Eddie, you're such a guy. He's standing up for us. Oh, Eddie, you don't need to do that. Eddie from the class of 38 and his PhD in 42 or 3, Eddie. Which one was it? Sue knows. 43. Okay. So anyway, Eddie, you know, thank you. And then is Bob Gibson here? He didn't make it. And then Bob Gibson, who I was going to highlight as well. I mean, Bob, beloved by this group, educator extraordinaire, associate dean, vice chancellor, a big proponent of diversity and outreach, a spectacular man. And I will say that mentioning all those people just reminds me that the journey continues, and that number one, you may or may not know, we've done a series of historic videos. The first one was done of Bob Day. We then performed one for Les Bennett. Eddie was the third that we just completed, and Bob Gibson has agreed to do the fourth. So we'll be doing Bob as well. Excuse me. And then the other thing I want to highlight is that yesterday, literally, we created new websites on the school's primary website. And there are three historical summaries of each of the three departments of the school going way back when. The people that were primarily responsible were Toby Herfindahl for clinical pharmacy, it was Tom James for PharmChem, and Les took that responsibility for what is now bioengineering and therapeutic sciences. And the last piece, and this was Toby's idea, it's a living document. You all are willing to contribute your comments, your memory of the history. We will grab it and add it to that. It will continue to evolve over time. So this just keeps going on, and it will really keep going on as we walk outside and enjoy this reception, where we will show a number of, again, historical photos as you all sip champagne. So thank you all. I hope you enjoyed it. Please enjoy. Bye-bye.